welcome kindly.
That's where I just came from. the north side St. Patrick's Day Parade. That's part of the diversity of our community. Last night, I was at the Asian Coalition dinner, which is just a huge, wonderful celebration every year. And each year, it's led by a different community. Yesterday, it was led by the Pakistani community, and it was larger than it's ever been before. It was absolutely wonderful. So I am just so incredibly proud to represent one of the most diverse districts in the country, and one that really is a magnet for people who come from all over the world. My staff told me, I don't know which main township, but one of them, approximately 75% of the students speak another language other than English at home. And that is true across the district. It's about 37%. So people come from absolutely everywhere. You know, there's a lot of things to say about the Trump administration and concerns that we have, but none concerns me more than the divisiveness, the way that this president and his administration has divided communities, one among another, turned people on each other, the incredible uptick in violence, in hate crimes, in bullying at school that we're seeing. And it's not isolated to any one community. The executive order on immigration has essentially given a green light to detaining just about anybody who has violated any law. And if you are here undocumented, then you certainly have violated what immigration law, at least by the books. Often that in the past has been treated as an administrative issue, not at all as a criminal issue. And now ICE has, let me just put it this way, people are terrified that there may be that knock on the door. There are schools where children are not going to school because they are too afraid that their parent will not be there when they get home because that parent has been detained. Let me put very clearly, in our offices, we have an office in Glenview and an office on Broadway in Chicago, 5533 Broadway. That is a sanctuary zone. I mean, people should feel free to come there to talk about the issues and the fears that they're facing and be certain that they will not be reported to immigration. In the executive order, there's also an attack on sanctuary cities. And what that means is, a sanctuary city is a city that says it will not use its local law enforcement to enforce federal immigration law. Now, we have found that sanctuary cities are actually safer. That's not an alternative fact, that's a fact. And the reason for that is that if you are an undocumented person, why in the heck would you call the police to report a crime against yourself, a crime that you may have witnessed, if you think you yourself will be turned over to immigration? And so we think that that makes our communities less safe to eliminate sanctuary cities, to have local law enforcement enforce national immigration law. And besides which, you know, and everybody's been talking about their history, and in the United States, most everybody has an immigrant history. Neither of my parents was born in the United States. Both, one from now, it's Lithuania, the other now from Ukraine, used to be all the Russia. Fleeing discrimination and violence against the Jewish community. And so they came with nothing in their pockets with their parents to the city of Chicago to make a better life for their children. And my grandfather, who sold fruits and vegetables from a horse and wagon, and I'm old enough to remember that, down the alleys of Humboldt Park, managed to send four, they helped, the kids helped too, but managed to send four children to college in the United States of America. That's the immigrant story. This is not an odd story. This is not an unusual story, because if you think about who leaves everything behind to come to another country, leaves their native language, their family, their home behind to come and seek a better life here. These are the people with the most ambition, with the most gumption, who are willing to work the hardest. The refugees and the immigrants are the best of the best who come to the United States of America. And they are our country. And then, of course, you've got the Muslim ban, which the version two is pretty much like version one of that ban. A few changes. It said that Iraq is now off the list. It no longer says that Christians are allowed in and Muslims are not. But of course they cut the number of people who are allowed into the United States. And I heard one of our students said she worked with refugee one, at least one, two, both of them? Okay, all of them, the three of you worked with refugee one. I went to the airport to greet a family that was being resettled by about 10 families in our community at large. It was just an incredible thing. My husband was able to meet them at the gate because his airplane had come in a little early. And they came down, a mother, a father, and three little children who, after years, talk about extreme vetting, years trying to get to the United States. What we have right now is extreme vetting.
Yes.
It is very hard to make the grade to come here as a refugee. And again, it's facts over fear. How many refugees to this country in the last 20 years have been a threat to our national security? That number is zero. It is zero. And so, and then not last Thanksgiving, but that before, I was invited to a Thanksgiving dinner with some refugee families. And it was typical Thanksgiving dinner. There was turkey and all the fixings. There was a fire in the fireplace, little kids running around, and just being grateful to have made it away from death in Syria, away from a refugee camp where they spent years trying to get vetted to come here, and finally made it to our community. This is who we are. This is the morality, or has been, of the United States of America. Now, I don't want to get too carried away, because let's remember, there were days where the Irish were not welcome in the United States. There was the Chinese Exclusion Act that was passed. The Japanese were interned in camps during World War II. But the echoes of those shameful marks on American history now are appearing again today. I want to give you one last story. A Muslim woman who works for me in my office on Broadway in Chicago, she's from Pakistan, and they were, or her family is, and they were celebrating her husband's birthday at a restaurant in Albany Park. So the family was gathered, and a white woman came up to them and started yelling at them, "Go back where you came from, you are not welcome here." And the family got up, some of the members of the family crying, and left the restaurant. And the owner of the restaurant throw the woman out of the restaurant. But no one in the restaurant, no diner, stood up to say, wrong. You cannot say that, and to stand around this family to protect them. And I hope everyone in this room, when you witness an act of bigotry, that you will do something about it. You will stand. I think that's why you're really here today. And God forbid, there is a registry of Muslims in this country. I know this Jewish woman will be a Muslim. Will you all get up and register? And we have seen acts of solidarity. And we have seen acts of people standing up. And I want to congratulate our young people who stood up today and said, this is not their country. This is not, I mean, the country that they want to live in that discriminates. This is their country that is welcoming, and I see signs about that. And so we need to stand up. I want to say a thank you. The Muslim community in St. Louis did fundraising in order to repair the damage at a Jewish cemetery that was desecrated by America. I want to thank you for coming out. I have been in many places now where Americans are saying the same thing, that we will not stand up. We will not tolerate bigotry in this country. We will stand up against it. And we are, America I know is great. And we don't need to be made great again. We are great, but we can't allow us to be divided. Thank you.